This is the B-24D. It is a large airplane, but that in itself does not mean that it is difficult or tricky to fly. It is obviously impossible to learn to fly by merely looking at a moving picture. However, it is hoped that picturizing the procedure for preparation, takeoff, and landing will be of some help by making each operation and the reason for it a little clearer. This film on How to Fly the B-24 is based on an appendix appearing in the Consolidated Flight Manual. This is a serious film. It is not entertainment. Nor is it truly an instruction film, since the subject is too complicated for teaching by this method alone. The picture can, however, help you to become a little more familiar with the things you must see and do in handling the B-24. If it accomplishes this, your time and our effort will be well spent. The operation of any airplane, single or multi-engine, requires certain operations performed in a definite sequence. This sequence, as it applies to the B-24D, is covered by a complete and explicit pilot's checklist. This list must be followed exactly and intelligently. We will cover each step of this checklist from the time the crew first approaches the airplane until they return to the field from their flight. And now, as the crew approaches the airplane, the flight engineer proceeds to open up. He unlocks and opens the small access door on the right side of the fuselage, and reaching in, opens the bomb doors by pulling outward on the handle of the auxiliary bomb door valve. The seasoned pilot makes certain that the pitot head covers are removed. He knows that the airspeed indicator is inoperative with them on and that it's awkward to remove them in flight. With the ship open, the pilot and co-pilot enter first and go forward to the cockpit. The flight engineer then enters. His first act is to turn on the four fuel selector valves. There is a valve for each engine, which is marked to connect the engine to a correspondingly numbered fuel system, or to the cross connection, which interconnects all valve units. The valves are located overhead. Two on the right of the center line, forward of the main spar, control flow to engines 3 and 4. The two valves on the left side control flow to engines 1 and 2. Off, on tank, on cross connection. The engineer next checks the fuel load. This is done at the two visual gauges located on the forward face of the bomb bay bulkhead. Each gauge is connected by a two-way valve with two of the four main fuel systems. By operating these valves, the quantity of fuel in each of the four systems can be determined. The inclinometer, located outboard of the gauges, must read zero for accurate gauge reading. An off-zero reading can cause a high percent of inaccuracy in gauging the fuel available. Systems 3 and 4 are on the inboard gauge, and systems 1 and 2 on the outboard gauge. All figures read in United States gallons. Refraction through that part of the glass filled with liquid changes the angles of the diagonal lines in back of the plastic tube and simplifies reading. Each system should have a minimum of 300 gallons, giving a total for the four systems of 1,200 United States gallons. In the cockpit, the pilot and co-pilot adjust their seats. The seat adjusting levers located outboard of each seat permit adjustment fore and aft, up and down, and tilt. Comfortable adjustment of the seats accomplished, the rudder pedals are set for proper length. Each pedal adjustment ratchet is located between the pedals. Push the ratchet lever away from the pedal with the toe and move the pedal fore or aft to the proper position, like this. Be sure all seat and pedal latches are firmly engaged. Now the co-pilot removes the controls lock, which holds the locking lever up in the lock position, and stows the strap securely in the overhead. Take up all the slack and secure the loose end so it won't slap your face. After this is done, check the locking lever in down to make sure that it is all the way down and the locks are completely released. With the controls unlocked, the pilot checks the movement and direction of the controls in the normal manner. The co-pilot or engineer simultaneously visually checks the actual movement of each control. Turning the wheel this way, the ailerons. The flight engineer calls out, right or left, aileron down, up. By wiggling the controls this way, the pilot can check for free movement. Now the elevators. By exercising the wheel fore and aft, like this, the elevators are checked for position and movement. The flight engineer calls out, elevators down. Elevators up, then a faster movement to check for free operation. Now the rudder movement. The flight engineer calls out, right and left rudder. Now rapid movement for a freedom check. These checks might seem superfluous, but controls have been found crossed after re-rigging. And now we're ready to begin the approved procedure for starting the engines. Before the engineer approaches the engines, the co-pilot must check the ignition switches off and the master ignition switch off. A kickback would result in serious injury to the engineer. Each engine must be pulled through by hand 6 blades, 2 complete revolutions, to warn of the presence or to clear fuel accumulated in the combustion chambers, which would damage the engine. Keep clear of the plane of propeller rotation. Don't become careless. The ignition switch off can be just like the famous unloaded gun. For starting the engines, power can be drawn one from the ship itself by using the batteries plus the auxiliary power unit, or two from outside the ship by using a battery card. For starting either way, the generator switches located on the generator panel are turned off. If the start is made with outside power from the battery cart, the plug connection is reached to the small access door on the right-hand side of the fuselage. The battery switches located over the master switch on the right side of the cockpit are turned off for starting with the battery card. When starting on ship's power, turn on these battery switches first. Then start the auxiliary power unit. If the batteries are fully charged, start the unit by power. Equalizer switch on. Fuel on. crime. Press the starter button. The generator then acts as a starting motor to turn the engine of the unit. If the batteries are low, to start by hand, wind the starter rope around the drum. Fuel on, prime, and pull the lanyard to turn the engine over. When it is running, turn the equalizer switch on. Now, turn on the four ignition switches. 4, 3, 2, and 1. And the master switch. As the engineer leaves to stand by the engines, he reaches overhead on the right side and turns on the switch for the electric hydraulic pump, which furnishes hydraulic power until number 3 engine starts. Wheel chocks, if available, are placed in front of each wheel. Even if chocks are used, the pilot sets the parking brake to keep the airplane from rolling when the engines start. Just press the pedals and lift the latch. The co-pilot turns on the alternating current power switch to either number 1 or number 2 inverter, which furnishes power for the engine instrument. Automatic flight control is checked off. The slide bar control left of the pedestal is pulled aft to disengage. If the automatic flight control is on, free operation of the controls is impossible. You can see here that the pilot is really tugging to try and move the controls. De-icer and anti-icer controls to right of pedestal on the panel are checked off. De-icers on will change the wing characteristic. The intercooler switches, forward and center on the pedestal, are thrown to open. Closed intercoolers would cause overheating and detonation. The cowl flap switches, right on the pedestal, are placed in the open position and so held until the cowl flaps are fully open. They must be fully open to permit air circulation to cool the engines during the start and warm-up period. The complete cycle from closed to open takes about 30 seconds. The propellers are set for high RPM. The switch bar is held to IMC, or increased revolutions, until indicator lights on the center of the panel flash on. All 4 supercharger controls are set to off, which opens the engine exhaust tailgates. If engines are started with turbo controls on, the tailgate would be closed, and the exhaust tailpipe would probably be blown out. Mixture controls are checked in idle cutoff before the boosters are turned on. The airplane fire extinguisher valves, located outboard of the co-pilot, are checked for position so that they can be operated quickly if needed. There are 2 selectors. The rear one directs gas to engines 3 and 4, and the one forward to engines 1 and 2. Furthermore, the flight engineer or mechanic always stands by starting engines with a large portable extinguisher. engines are started in the order of 3, 4, 2, and 1. They're started from inboard to outboard so that the engineer does not have to walk through or toward a moving propeller. Number 3 engine is started first because the only engine-driven hydraulic pump is attached to it. The co-pilot looks to see that all personnel and obstructions are clear of the propellers and checks all clear with the engineer. Then the fuel booster pumps are turned on. Booster pressure is required for priming and to ensure an adequate fuel pressure until the engine-driven pumps take hold. While the pilot opens number 3 throttle 1/3, energizing the starter is accomplished by the co-pilot holding the number 3 energizer switch to accel. With his other hand, the co-pilot primes the number 3 engine. For better prime, the switch is pressed intermittently to inject the fuel in spurts. The accel position is held for 12 seconds and then the crank switch is thrown. Meanwhile, the accel switch is held on to keep the starter turning during cranking. When the engine fires on the priming charge, the mixture control is thrown from idle cutoff to auto lean. Auto lean is used for starting, warm-up, and taxiing. Auto rich, or full rich, gives an abnormally rich mixture at low speeds and will foul the plugs or load the engine. With the mixture control and idle cutoff, there is no flow of fuel, but as soon as the lever is moved from idle cutoff, a valve is opened and fuel flows to the carburetor jets. Therefore, if the engine does not run immediately, return the mixture control lever to idle cutoff to prevent flooding, a critical fire hazard. For warm-up, the mixture control remains in auto lean. With number 3 running, start engine number 4. Throttle open 1/3, accelerate, prime. Crank. Mixture control to auto lean. Next, engine number 2. Throttle open 1/3. Accelerate. Prime. Crank. Mixture control to auto lean. Engine number 1. Throttle open 1/3. Accelerate. Prime. Crank. This one fails to fire immediately. The mixture control is returned to idle cutoff. Now, with added prime, it takes hold. So back to auto lean. With engine number 1 started and running, the instruments of all 4 engines are checked and warm-up begins. Keep an eye on the engine instruments during warm-up. Warm up slowly so that the oil has ample time to start circulating freely. Turn off boosters. Never exceed 1,400 revolutions per minute in auto lean on the ground. Now with the engines running at 1,000 RPM, the pilot checks all gauges. The oil pressure drops to the operating range as the temperature rises. Oil pressure, 45 to 50 pounds. Fuel pressure, 14 pounds. Manifold pressure, 15 inches. Warm up until the oil temperature gauges indicate 40 to 60 degrees centigrade. Engines 1 and 2 on the left gauge, and 3 and 4 on the right. The head temperature gauges likewise have two hands, 1 and 2 left, 3 and 4 right. There are two vacuum pumps, one on engine number 1 and one on engine number 2. While the engines are warming up, check both pumps. The selector valve is located under the generator panel. The faceplate gives each source of vacuum and to where the supply is directed. It has no off position. At 1,000 RPM, the vacuum gauge on the pilot's panel should read from 4 to 4.5 inches. Now check the brake pressure. The gauges should read between 850 and 1125 pounds. Throw the de-icer lever, located to the left of the co-pilot's control column under the switch panel, to the right to on, and see that the de-icer boots inflate and deflate. The de-icer boots are in segments, so it's necessary to check each one. Right outboard section, the vacuum pump inflates and deflates the alternate tubes. Section outboard of engines, inflate and deflate the alternate tubes. Inflate, deflate, and inflate alternate tubes. Section between engine and fuselage, and also the tail group. The pump inflates, deflates, and inflates the alternate tubes. When this check is completed, turn the de-icer control off and check the anti-icer fluid flow to the propellers. The fluid motors are operated by this rheostat on the panel behind the mixture controls. It is calibrated in gallons per hour. For clarity, flow of fluid is shown with the propeller idle. When the propeller is revolving, the fluid runs out along the blade. Turn the fluid off when the check is completed. Wheel blocks are removed. And when the last crew member enters the airplane, he closes the bomb doors by pulling on the auxiliary bomb door handle under the flight deck on the right side. The handle must be held until the doors are closed. When the brake pedals are pressed, the spring-loaded parking brake lever automatically disengages and releases the parking brakes. Before taxiing away from the line, the pilot again checks the propellers for high RPM by throwing the bar of the propeller switch to increase. When the propellers are in high RPM, the four governor limit lights are illuminated. Now we're ready to go. The wise pilot taxis the plane to the head of the runway for the final run-up and preparation so that he can take off immediately thereafter and avoid the fouled engines inevitably caused by long idling. The maneuver of turning to taxi from the line should be executed in a broad, sweeping turn like this, with the power for the turn being furnished by the outboard engines. The brakes should be used very little, if at all, in taxiing, and then only applied gently. There is ample control with the outboard engines. You can see how easily the airplane can be maneuvered and controlled as it is being deliberately S-turned with the outboard engines. The B-24D is a large airplane, but when properly handled and kept under control by mild use of power and brakes, it can be handled as easily as a small plane. Notice how the inboard wheel is turning in a generous radius. The tires are not skidding, and the nose wheel is not canted at an extreme angle. This is the way not to handle an airplane. There is absolutely no excuse for abusing an airplane in this manner. If it were even moderately loaded, such violent application of the brakes would in all probability cause nose wheel failure. Abrupt turns like this are prohibited. Notice that the inboard tire is twisting and that the nose wheel is canted at an extreme angle. It is against the stops and it's sliding. And now the B-24D, without violent abuse of brakes, taxis to the head of the runway. Reel 2 of this series deals with final run-up, takeoff, use of flaps, preparation for landing, the safety checks which must be made before the airplane touches the ground, and finally, the securing after flight. The airplane has been properly warmed up, prepared for flight, and is taxiing out to the takeoff area. On arriving at the head of the runway, the pilot stops the airplane and sets the parking brakes again. Press the pedals, lift the parking lever, and the brakes are on. And now comes the final check and engine run-up preparatory to takeoff. The co-pilot sets the throttles of all four engines evenly. At this speed, check the propellers for full range. Check first to full low RPM, high pitch. Press the switch bar to decrease revolutions, abbreviated DEC, and hold it until the limit lights all flash on. High pitch is used in normal flight because the airplane has forward motion and demands a heavier grip. Now the switches are changed. The switch bar is thrown to INC for low pitch, high RPM, and held until the lights on the instrument panel flash on again. At high RPM, the engine develops rated power while the airplane is accelerating from a standstill. When the limit lights flash on again, the propellers are in full low pitch and the switch is released. Next item, the pilot adjusts the control tabs for best takeoff. Elevator tabs, 1 degree tail heavy. Aileron tabs, neutral. Rudder, 2 degrees to 2.5 degrees right rudder to provide for engine torque. These settings are for normal conditions and loading. The pilot again checks the automatic flight control, or pilot, off. The controls for freedom of movement and the de-icer off. These checks should become automatic with experience because they affect the control and safety of the airplane. The co-pilot sets all of the mixture controls to auto-rich. Never take off in auto-lean, because the mixture is too lean for high power. Engines will overheat and detonation will result. Detonating engines have been known to stop completely and suddenly. Never attempt to use intermediate mixture positions. Check the fuel pressure with the booster pump off, 14 to 16 pounds. And then to on the booster pumps for takeoff. The booster switches are the top row under the panel to the left of the co-pilot's control column. Again, check the engine head temperatures before run-up. They must be between 150 degrees and 205 degrees centigrade. The red line shows maximum temperature allowed in the air, but is too high for takeoff. Now we're ready to run up the engines. It is done one at a time, usually from right to left. Watch the tachometer and manifold pressure as throttle number 4 is opened slowly to 2,000 RPM. Check mag switches right and left with an allowable drop of 75 RPM on either. Now, open the throttle wide against the stop. Engine superchargers give about 36 to 37 inches manifold pressure at sea level. With throttle wide open, move the turbo supercharger control slowly to on. Manifold pressure increases from the engine supercharger boost to the final sea level takeoff setting of 49 inches at 2,700 RPM. The turbo supercharger provides the added 12 inches boost. Now, retard the throttle slowly again to 1,000. Now, on number 3 engine, open the throttle to 2,000 RPM. Check the magnetos. Then, before opening the throttles wider, extend the wing flaps in order to take advantage of the hydraulic pump, which is only on this engine. To stop the flaps before full up or down, the operating lever is returned manually to neutral when the flap indicator reaches the position desired. The Fowler flaps are set to 10 degrees down for best average takeoff. This setting gives maximum performance in case of engine failure. 20 degrees extended flaps is the best setting for takeoff and gives maximum lift. For normal operation, however, the 10-degree setting is recommended. Now, open number 3 throttle wide to the stop. Open turbo supercharger slowly to the stop. The control is opened slowly to permit the regulator to stabilize. Check the power instruments. They should read 49 inches at 2,700 revolutions per minute. All engine control movements should be executed slowly to avoid abrupt power changes. Here, number 3 engine is kicking up the dust at full power output. Retard the throttle slowly again to 1,000. Engine 2. Open throttle to 2,000 RPM. Check the magnetos, right and left. Open the throttle wide. Manifold pressure 37 inches. Open turbo supercharger slowly to the stop. Check the power instruments, which should read 49 inches manifold pressure at 2,700 RPM. Number 2 blasts away. And now retard the throttle slowly to 1,000 RPM. Engine 1. Open the throttle to 2,000 RPM. Check the magnetos, right and left. Open the throttle wide. Open the turbo supercharger slowly to the stop. Number one blasts away. All four engines have now been checked and are performing to the pilot's satisfaction. The throttle is retarded slowly back to 1,000 RPM. After the turbo controls are set, they are left on, and the throttles are set to maintain approximately 800 to 1,000 RPM. This is slightly above normal idling speed, but prevents fouling of the plugs and keeps the turbo superchargers turning at a fair rate of speed. The left friction drag is tightened to hold the turbo control levers. The four generators are now cut in at the control panel, located outboard of the fuel gauges. The four switches are turned on one at a time. Generators are left off until after run-up because the excessive vibration on the ground adversely affects the voltage regulators. Now we gun each engine slightly to check the charge as its generator comes on. Number four, 50 amps. Note that the voltage rises as each generator comes in. This is normal. Number three, 50 amps. Number two, 50 amps at 28 volts. And number one, 50 amps at 28 volts. All generators are satisfactory. Close the cowl flaps to one-third open for takeoff. Open cowl flaps reduce speed about 8/10 of a mile per hour for each degree of opening. Furthermore, with cowl flaps more than one-third open, tail buffeting results below 150 miles an hour indicated. Again, move the landing gear lever to down, and on the hydraulic gauge above the pilot's control column, check kickout pressure at 825 to 875 pounds per square inch. Check the artificial horizon uncaged and also the directional gyro. Set the altimeter for the barometric reading at the airport. Check that the nose wheel compartment is clear of the crew. Now we are set for the takeoff run. Press the brake pedals to release the parking lever, which drops down, and the brakes are released again. The pilot gets an okay from the tower and swings around into the wind heading down the runway. Then he opens the throttle slowly and evenly against the stops, where they are held by the co-pilot to keep them against any tendency of creeping closed. The throttle frictions are only lightly set for takeoff. Therefore, during the run, the co-pilot holds the throttles open and adjusts the turbo supercharger controls to equalize all manifold pressures at the 49-inch top limit. As the plane accelerates, the pilot applies a gentle back pressure on the controls to assist in lifting the plane on the gear. At 110 miles per hour, the plane with a moderate load easily leaves the ground. Hold the nose down and maintain the takeoff course until the indicated airspeed reaches 135 miles per hour. At this speed, full control is available in case of outboard engine failure. As soon as the airplane is well clear of the ground and definitely airborne, the landing gear is raised. If the landing gear fails to retract immediately, it is usually due to air in the system. To bleed it out, work the operating lever through up and down cycles until the action is normal. Usually, two or three cycles are sufficient. Lever up for a moment. Down. Up again. Down again. And now, here it goes all the way up. Now we retard the turbo control levers to reduce the manifold pressure to 45.5 inches, the maximum pressure allowable at the continuous power rate for 1 hour. With the propeller control switches, the co-pilot reduces revolutions to 2550, while the pilot readjusts the manifold pressure as the propeller pitch increases. After the landing gear lever has returned to neutral, the flaps may be raised at the pilot's discretion. Landing gear and flap control valves are operated only one at a time, never together. Do not exceed 155 miles per hour airspeed with the flaps extended. The fuel booster pumps are turned off, as their auxiliary pressure is not needed again until the fuel pressure drops 2 pounds due to altitude or until turned on again for a landing. Close the cowl flaps to a minimum opening required to maintain proper head temperatures. High airspeed cools better than open cowl flaps. Maximum head temperatures are 260 degrees in auto-rich and 232 degrees in auto-lean. Check the engine instruments. Oil pressure 75 to 90. Fuel pressure 14 to 16. Maximum oil temperature is 75 degrees centigrade in auto-lean. In auto-rich, for rated power 85 degrees and military power for 5 minutes 100 degrees are the maximum. The auxiliary hydraulic electric motor is turned off if other than a purely local flight is being made. Now we're assuming that the mission has been completed and that the airplane is returning to its base. As it circles the field, before entering the pattern, the pilot reduces speed to 155 miles per hour. He notifies the crew that the airplane is coming in for a landing and receives the report that the nose wheel compartment is clear of the crew. The hydraulic switch is turned on as the main hydraulic power will not be available when number 3 engine is throttled. The accumulator brake pressure is checked between 850 and 1125 pounds. Make sure that the automatic flight control or pilot is turned off. A landing would be difficult while attempting to overpower the automatic flight control. Cowl flaps are now closed to prevent rapid engine cooling in the glide, to eliminate tail buffeting as the speed is reduced, and to cut down head resistance in case the landing is refused. Mixture controls are placed in auto rich, the only position where full power is available. Intercooler shutters are open unless the carburetor is icing, but when used, watch the head temperatures. Turn on the booster pumps to ensure a positive flow of fuel to the engine pumps. The wing de-icers are turned off. Be sure to check this because the inflated shoes, when operating, become wing spoilers and change the landing characteristics. Move the landing gear lever to up to check the kickout pressure. This should be from 1,050 to 1,100 pounds. Then move the landing gear lever to the rear and downward to the down position. The lever will return to neutral when the gear is down. The landing gear lever may return prematurely due to surge, so it is necessary for a crew member to inspect all the latches. Each main landing gear latch can be seen from the rear window on each side. The top of the latch is painted a bright yellow to make identification easier and looks like this, unlatched. Unlatched and latched. The main landing gear latches cannot be seen with the flaps extended. Again, unlatched, latched. As the gear drops, the nose wheel comes down last because the main gear falls by gravity while the nose gear needs power. When engaged, the nose gear latch from the nose wheel compartment looks like this. Be sure it's properly engaged. Very sure, because it is important. After the landing gear lever has kicked back to neutral and the gear has been checked carefully and reported back to the pilot, with speed still at 155 miles per hour, we enter the landing lane. When in the groove, lower the wing flaps 20 degrees by moving the flap lever on the right of the pedestal to the rear. When the flap indicator reads 20 degrees, the control lever is returned manually to neutral. The half-down flap is recommended for the beginning of the approach, as the lift and drag are both increased at low speed, and the attitude of the airplane is changed for a wider range of vision during landing. Turbo controls are turned off normally. When landing at altitude, they are left in the position to furnish the required manifold pressure. Then handle the throttles carefully. A backfire may blow off the tailpipe. As you approach the boundary of the field now, place the flap lever in the down position. When the flaps are extended fully, the lever will return to neutral automatically and the indicator will show 40 degrees. Always allow sufficient time to settle into the new attitude before the final level off or flare. Move the landing gear lever to the down position again for final check and to ensure pressure in the line. Throw the propeller control switch to increase for high revolutions per minute so that full power is available in case of a refused landing. As the airplane glides in for a landing, the throttles are retarded and the tabs are adjusted to maintain proper balance. To maintain a steady approach, a slight amount of power is usually necessary. Adjust the throttles as power is needed to keep the proper airspeed and position. Begin the flare with ample altitude for control response. Remember, this airplane has great momentum due to its weight and resists sudden changes of direction. The best landing attitude is the conventional one for airplanes not equipped with tricycle gear. Never land in an attitude which allows the nose wheel to make ground contact first. Now, as we pass the boundary and are in the landing position, the throttles are closed and held by the co-pilot to keep them from creeping open. Tabs are adjusted to lighten the control load. Now, over the runway, the pilot holds his airplane off, pulling the nose up for normal landing. This is the attitude for normal landing, with the airplane held off as long as possible. Notice how easily and smoothly the airplane touches the ground. As soon as the ship is definitely on the ground, the co-pilot places the mixture controls in auto-lean. If the field is short and the brakes must be applied immediately, a three-point landing is permissible. When a three-point landing is made, it is done with the main wheels and the nose wheel touching the ground simultaneously. Notice again with the three-wheel landing how smoothly the plane makes contact and how moderately the brakes are applied after the nose wheel is firmly on the ground. On airplanes equipped with retractable tail skids, an emergency landing may be made tail down with the tail skid hitting the ground simultaneously with the main wheels. Here he comes now for a tail skid landing to show how high the nose of the plane may be maintained. By sending crew members aft after the plane makes contact, the tail skid may be kept on the ground for a long run, requiring no use of the brakes in a field of average length. After the plane has slowed to taxiing speed, the co-pilot should open the cowl flaps immediately to prevent overheating. Wing flaps should be raised before taxiing so that mud or rocks cannot be thrown into the overflap or tracks. When the flaps retract fully, the lever returns to neutral. Remember, turn and taxi slowly. Use the engines to steer. Don't use too much throttle. And keep the airplane well under control. The pilot here has perfect control as he taxis off the runway and turns to the parking area. Watch the use of the outboard engines. Upon arriving at the parking area, the engines are stopped. To do so, place the mixture controls in idle cutoff. 4, 3, 2, and 1. The throttles are opened as the engines stop. After the engines have stopped, the bomb doors are opened. Ignition switches, 4, 3, 2, and 1 are cut, and the master switch is turned off. Battery switch is off. Booster switches are turned off. AC power switch off. Generator switches are turned off. Auxiliary hydraulic pump off. And the wheel chocks are placed under the wheels. Now, center the service controls. Raise the control locking lever and secure it with the strap. Before leaving the airplane, the landing gear lever is placed in the down position. If the brakes are set while the drums are still hot, the internal brake mechanism will be damaged. Therefore, set the parking brakes only after the drums have cooled. Press the pedals and lift the lock. Cowl flaps are closed, but not until after the engine cools, because the heat retained within the engine will burn out the spark plug terminals.